Good day. Today we're going to discuss CE2121 Module 12, Horizontal Curves. So when we talk about curves, these are usually employed in lines for changes in direction at intersections of straight lines at gradual slope. So when we say change in direction, this could either be a direction along the horizontal, so you move to the left or right, or a curve that would change directions along the vertical, so if you go up or down. So these lines now are connected by curves that are tangent to it and are called tangents or straights. So these curves could be connected as a curve to curve or a curve to a tangent line and then to a curve. They are generally circular arcs but may also be parabolic. So for circular arcs, these are the curves we used for horizontal direction or horizontal change in directions. Well, for parabolic curves, these are used for the change in direction along your verticals. The purpose of our curves would simply be to deflect lines safely and comfortably through a deflection angle theta to enable a continuous journey. So with the curves, this is used now so as not to have very sharp curves on your horizontal and very steep slope on your vertical. Okay, so there are two types of curves. We have your horizontal curves and vertical parabolic curves. So today we are going to discuss only horizontal curves. So horizontal curves, these are used now for your horizontal alignment. So this is the top view or plan view of your route. So this is, if this is our route, so this is a straight line and you want to change direction towards the, so towards the south. So you cannot directly go down actually when you're driving your vehicle. So you have to add now a horizontal curve in order to have a smooth and safe transition of direction. So this is one of the two important transition elements in geometric design of highways or of roads together with your vertical curves. So it provides transition between two tangent strips of roadways, allowing a vehicle to negotiate or turn at a gradual rate rather than a sharp curve. So it is dependent on the intended design speed for the roadway, as well as other factors including drainage and friction. So this is another example of your horizontal curve. So you design it so as not to obstruct or not to hit any obstruction along your route. Okay. So for horizontal curves, we have different types. We have the first one, which is a simple curve, which consists of a single arc connecting two straight lines. And the second one is a compound curve, which is a composition of two simple curves or two arcs with different radii. Okay, so it bends in the same direction and the radii and centers would lie on the same side of the route. The next one is a reverse curve, which is also consisting of two arcs, which could either be equal or unequal. But the difference here is that they are bending on opposite directions and they will have common tangential or tangents at their junction or at their connection. So the center lies now on opposite sides of the curve. And next is your spiral curve, which will have varying radius at certain length. So this is specifically used in railroads and sometimes for modern highways. So this provides transition from a tangent to a simple curve or between simple curves in a compound curve. So for today, we'll only be focusing on the first three types of horizontal curves, which are more likely circular curves. So, okay, and for spiral curves, this is also known as a transition curve. So let's have a simple diagram. So for a simple curve, so it has two tangents. So this was your initial roadway. This is your second roadway. So in order to have a smooth transition for lines 1 and 2, you will be connecting a single curve to them. So this is a simple curve. Okay. Next, we have your compound curve. So we'll be connecting still two tangents, T1 and T2. But instead of a single line or a single arc, we'll have now two curves of different radius. So they are bending on the same side. And then we have your reverse curve. So still connecting T1 and T2. So we'll be connecting it with two arcs at curving at opposite directions. So the center are on the opposite sides of the curve. And lastly, we have your spiral curve. So you have several curves with different radius to connect your tangents, or you could also use this to connect two simple curves. So if you have a simple curve, tapos you could also add a spiral and then another simple curve or a compound curve. So analysis for simple, compound, and reverse curve would be simply the application of your geometry and trigonometry. And then for spiral, it's also trigo and geometry, but it's more complicated. Okay, so to understand further horizontal circular curves, let's start off first with a simple curve. So for a simple curve, it will have now a different component. So let's take this diagram. So for this diagram, we have here the point of intersection, PI. So this one. So it simply means it is the intersection between your back tangents and forward tangents, or their initial and final and second roads being connected. Then next, we have your PC, this point, which is now the point of curvature or the beginning of curve. So some books would call this BC instead of PC. And the next one is our point of tangency, which is the point of end of curve. So it is the point wherein the curve terminates towards the second tangent. So for some books, they also call this, instead of PT, they call it EC, or end of curve. Okay. So for the next element of our simple curve, we have your back tangent. So this is our first tangent, or the rear tangent, or your initial road. So it's the tangent before the start of the curve, or this is the tangent at PC. And then next, we have your forward tangent. So this is our forward tangent, which is defined as your second tangent, or the tangent after the end of the curve, or the tangent at PT. Okay, and we have your radius. So this is our radius. So this is R, this is also R. Okay, so next we have the length of curve, which is the distance from PC to PT along our arc. So this is our L, or length of curve. So when we talk of the curve, it is the arc length. Then we have the length of chord, LC. So this is the linear distance between PC and PT. Okay, so the distance between PC and PT can be defined by its arc or its linear distance. So if it's the arc, it's the length of curve. If it's the linear distance, it is the length of the chord. Okay, so next we have the tangent T. So for tangents T, we have two So this is the distance from tangents to the point of intersection. So it's PC to PI and PI to PT. So that's tangent, tangent. Okay, next we have your deflection angle, I. So that is the angle from the extension of the back tangent to your forward tangent. So it's also called the intersection angle. So that is I. And then we have your central angle, delta, which is now the angle subtended at the center of the curve by the arc, or it's the angle created by the two radii or radius. So this is your delta, which is also equal to your deflection angle or intersection angle. So this angle is the same as this angle. Okay. So next we have your external distance, E. The external distance is the distance from the PI to the apex or the highest point of your curve. So this is our external distance. And we have what we call your middle ordinate or the distance M, which is now the distance between the apex or midpoint of the curve and the long chord. So this distance. Okay, so this is E, the external, and then we have here the middle distance. So it's like a line connecting PI and the center. So the external is the outside of the curve and the middle is the distance at the middle. Okay, so the long chord is also called the, or our, length of chord is also called your long chord. Okay? So next we have here a diagram or summary of our simple curve, the components. So we have the back tangent again. We have the forward tangent, our PI or our BC, beginning of curve. We have here your PI, point of intersection. We have the EC, end of curve, or our PT. So we have here our external distance, our middle ordinate. This is the long chord, or simply the chord. Or, and then we have here your length of curve. So we have here your radius. So this is our central angle, which is the same as our intersection angle. And take note that the angle created by the radius, by one radius, and the line connecting the center and our point of intersection is equal to half of your central angle. And also the angle created by the long chord and your tangent is equal to half of the central angle. So this is also half of delta. Okay? So last component of a simple curve, which is one of the most important components that we are going to solve for simple curves, is the degree of curve or D. The degree of curve now can be computed in two ways. So this one now will define the sharpness of the curve. We have your arc definition, which is mostly used in highway design. And the second definition is by its chord, which is mostly used in railway design and some highway works. Okay, so if it's not given in the problem, so please use it, use the arc definition. But if it's stated in the problem to use the chord definition, then use the chord definition. Or for example, if in the problem, it was stated that what we are designing is a highway, then automatic you use the arc definition. But if it's stated that we are designing a railway, then you use the chord definition for our degree of curve. So what's the difference between arc and chord definitions of your degree of curvature? So for arc definition, from the term itself, we are referring now or going to solve for the degree of curvature in terms of our arc. So let's take into consideration this simple curve. So we have here your radius. So considering now an arc which is 100 feet or almost 20 meters in length, and we have here your, so for a 100 feet or 20 meter arc, it will have a corresponding value of d. Okay, so with that, we compare now the ratio of d and 360 degrees, which is the angle for a whole circle. So we equate it to the ratio for the corresponding lengths of the arc. So for d, we have 100. 360 is for the circumference of the circle, or the total length of a circle, or in metric, that's 20 meters over c. So c, as we know, is 2 pi r, or we can now get the relationship between the degree of curve and your radius of curvature. So the degree of curvature now is equal to 1145.916 all over r. So this is taken from 360 and 2 pi. So you can memorize this equation, or you could simply derive it from this one. Okay, so if the degree of curvature is known, then you can find for the radius. Or if the radius is known, then you can solve for the degree of curvature. Okay, so next we have your chord definition. For the chord definition, we are now going to define the degree of curvature instead of the arc. We are going to use now the length of the chord. So let's say we have a length of chord which is at 100 feet or 20 meters. So this length now of chord will also have an equivalent degree of curvature. So in order to solve now for the degree of curvature in terms of our radius, we now consider this triangle. So this angle now is equal to d over 2. So from the right triangle, we have here half of LC, so this is 10, this is the radius, and this is your angle. So from right triangles, we have a sine. So sine of d over 2 is equal to 50 feet over r, or in metric, that's 10 meters over r. Or simplifying now, we have the radius is equal to 10 divided by sine of d over 2. So again, you can memorize this equation, or you could simply derive it from the triangle. Okay, so for arc definition, it's 1145.916 all over r, and for chord definition, that is sine d over 2 equal to 10 divided by r. So this is for metric. Okay, if you are going to use feet, just substitute the values in our equations. So for our formula, we have now here for the tangent distances of the simple curve, so these lines, we could now take into consideration this angle created by the tangent and your radius of curvature. So as we know, tangents would make a perpendicular angle with the radius. So this is a right angle. So given now tangent and radius and this angle, which is delta over 2, we could solve now for t as r tangent of delta 2. And then next, we have your chord distance, LC, this one. So we could solve this now as using this triangle now, the radius, this length of LC, which is half of its length, and the angle delta over 2. So from here, it's an angle opposite a side. So we'll have now sine of delta 2, or delta over 2 is equal to LC over 2 divided by r, or LC over 2 is equal to r sine of delta over 2. Then next, we have your length of curve. So, this length, this is now computed based on the ratio of the length of the curve divided by the angle subtended to, and its equivalent circumference and angle of a circle created by circle. So that's L over delta equal to 2 pi r equal to 360. And then for middle ordinates and your external distances, we could solve this now using our triangles, so by geometry, or we have here a more simplified equation for m, that's r times 1 minus cosine delta over 2, and for e, that's equal to tangent times, or t times the tangent of delta over 4, or in terms of your radius, it's equal to r times 1 over cosine of delta 2, delta over 2 minus 1. So again, you can memorize these equations, or you could just simply solve it by trigo and geometry. Okay? So we have the next type of horizontal curve, which is the compound curve. So for the components of a compound curve, we'll have almost the same components like our simple curves, but we'll just have some additional components. So for the components of a compound curve, let us take into consideration this given curve. So we have two curves with different radii. So the first component will be the radius of curves 1 and 2. So R1 and R2. So it's R1, R2. And for PC, or the point of curvature, or the start or beginning of the curve. So we also have the point of tangency, or the end of the curve. And we have what we call your PCC, or point of compound curve. That is the point wherein curve 1 and curve 2 will connect. And then we have your PI, or your point of intersection, at which our tangents 1 and 2 will intersect. So T1 is the tangent length of curve 1, and this one is the tangent length for curve 2. Then we have what we call your common tangent, which passes through our PCC. So this is our common tangent, and the common tangent now will be computed as T1, or the length of the common tangent will be computed as T1 plus T2. So this is T1 plus T2. Next, we have your V1 and V2, which are the vertices for curve 1 and 2, wherein V1 is the intersection of tangent 1 and the common tangent. And we have V2, which is the tangent, or the intersection of tangent 2 and common tangent. Next, we have your internal, or your central angles for curve 1 and 2. So we have I1 and I2. And the sum now of I1 and I2 is the angle of intersection of tangents 1 and 2. So that's given as I1 plus I2. And then next, we have your L1, L2, or the length of the curve, or arc length of curves 1 and 2. And we have LC1 and LC2, which is the chord lengths for curves 1 and 2 respectively. And we have LC, which is the length of chord, or the long chord from PC to PT. And from the diagram, we'll also have here angles I1 and I2. So the angle created by the tangent line and the common common tangent is I1, and the angle created by tangent 2 and the common tangent is the same as I2. And this angle now will be equal to angle theta, or that's 180 minus I. So we need these values later on to solve for some of the values required for our computations. So the analysis of a compound curve will be the same as for simple curves. The difference is we just have another curve to be analyzed. So we use the same equations for the degree of curve, your external distances and middle ordinates, lengths of arcs and chords for each curve, and we'll have some additional equations as such for the stationings of your point of tangencies and point of curvature. So for PT, if you want to take the station at PT, this can be computed now as the station of PC plus the length of curve 1 and curve 2. Okay, so we take the true length of the curve. We do not use the chord length. Okay, another way for solving for the stations. So if you want to have the station of PC, this can be solved as station of your point of intersection minus this value, x minus tangent 1. So the stationing will be dependent on the given stations. Okay, so x can be solved now from the triangle VI or V1 PI. So next type of horizontal curve is your reversed curve. So for the components of a reversed curve, we'll have almost the same as for simple and compound curves. So for our reversed curve, let's take this figure to analyze. So the first component, we have your radius 1 and the radius 2, or R1 and R2. Next, we have your point of curvature, point C, which is the beginning of your curve, so PC. And then we have your PT as well, which is the end of the curve or point of tangency. Then we have your PRC, or point of reverse curvature, or this is the point where our curves connect or changes direction. So it's the point of reversal. Then next, we have your tangents 1 and tangents 2. So the tangent lengths for curves 1 and curves 2. So this, which is also with the same length for T1 and T2 here. So this line is our common tangent. So the common tangent is also equal to T1 plus T2, same as for compound curve. And then we have V1, V2, which are the vertices for curve 1 and curve 2. Again, V1 is the intersection of T1 and the common tangent. And then we have V2, which is the intersection of T2 and your common tangent. Next, we have I1 and I2, or the central angles of curves 1 and curve 2. Then we have length 1 and length 2, or the arc length of curves 1 and 2. So L1, L2. Then we have LC1, LC2, or the chord length of the curve 1 and curve 2. So again, common tangent length will be T1 plus T2, or that is vertex 1 to vertex 2. For the analysis of a reverse curve, still same analysis as for simple and compound curves. We use the same equations for degree of curvature, external distances, middle ordinates, length of arcs, and chords. Additional equation, this is for stationing, so for PT, that is now equal to the station of PC plus the length of curve 1 and curve 2. Or station PT can be solved as station of V1 minus T1 plus L1 plus L2. So you cannot do the stationing at V1 plus T1 plus L2. You'll have a different stationing there. So you have to go back first from PC before you get the stationing of PT. Okay? So if we're given the station of PRC or point of reverse curve, then that's simply for PT, station of PRC plus L2, or for station of PC, that will be PRC minus arc length of curve 1. Okay, so for stationing of PT, again, reminder, you always have to take the stationing of PT from PC. So you have to go back to PC always. So for reverse curves, we have two types of reverse curves. We have a non-parallel tangent and a parallel tangent. So when we say non-parallel tangent, the tangents, the back tangent and the forward tangent, the back tangent of the first curve and the forward tangent of the second curve are not parallel. While for reverse curves with parallel tangents, it means that the back tangent of the first curve and the forward tangent of the second curve are parallel. Okay? So, okay, for us to understand or better understand horizontal curves, let us solve some sample problems. So, we have the bearings of the tangents of a simple curve would form an angle of intersection of 141 degrees, 23 minutes. If the degree of curve is 20 degrees for a chord distance of 20 meters, find the radius and tangent distances. So for this problem, we have here a simple curve. So we are given from the problem the value of the angle of intersection, which is equal to 141 degree, 23 minutes. So as we have said, I is also equivalent to your central angle. So from here, in order to solve for the radius and tangent distances, we now can solve for the radius using our degree of curvature. And since the given is a chord distance, therefore we are going to use the chord definition for our equation for degree of curves. So we have already derived the equation for chord definition from this diagram. So we have a chord distance of 20 and we have here d over 2. So we're going to use this triangle now with values 10 meters. So, the degree of curve is 10 degrees. And we'll have now R is equal to 10 divided by sine of 10, giving us a value of 57.588 meters for the radius. And to solve for our tangent distance, we are now going to use this triangle. So this is our tangent, our radius. So this is one half of the internal or the central angle. So we have here a right triangle, so opposite over adjacent, that will now be equivalent to tangent I over 2 equal to the tangent distance all over the radius. Or our tangent distance now is equal to 164.368 meters. Okay, we have the next problem. A compound curve laid under tangents have the following data. We have the intersection angles for the first and second curves at 31 degrees and 36 degrees respectively. We have the degree of curves for curve 1 and curve 2 at 3 and 5 degrees respectively. So from this data, we have to determine the radii of the curves, the length of the common tangent, through tangent that is passing through point PCC. We also compute for the length of the compound curve and the chord length from PC to PT. If the station at the point of intersection is 100 plus 20 meters, we have to determine the stations of PT and PC. So with this regard, we have now also the total intersection angles of your tangents 1 and 2. That is now equal to 31 plus 36, or that's 67. And to solve now for our other values, we will be needing the value of x and y. Okay. So to solve for our radii of curvatures, since we are given the degree of curve already, we can solve it by our arc definition, which is now equal to 1145.92 all over d. So you can use the given equation already, or you can simply derive it from this figure. So it's a ratio and proportion of an arc and a circle. So with this, for curve 1, that will now be 1145.92 divided by the degree of curvature of curve 1, and that will give us 381.972. and for curve 2, we'll have now the same equation, but the value of d will be the degree of curve for the second curve, which is equal to 5. So R2 now is equal to 229.183 meters. So from this, we could now solve for our length of common tangent by solving for the individual lengths of the tangents for each curve. And with this, for curve 1, we consider this triangle. So we have your tangent length. This one is your radius. And we know that this angle is 1/2 of the central angle. So we can now use also for curve 2, this triangle. So this is tangent 2, this is radius 2, and this one is 1/2 of the central angle of curve 2, which is 36. So from there on, we can now use tangent 1 is equal to R1, tangent of 31 all over 2. So we use the value of R computed. So T1 now is equivalent to 105.931. Then for curve 2, we use now the same equation, but instead of using R1, we use now the value of computed R2 and the given central angle of curve 2. So this will give us now a value of 74.66 meters. And once we have solved for T1 and T2, as we have said, the length of the common tangent is simply equal to T1 plus T2, and it will give us 180.397 meters. So next required is for our chord length of the compound curve. So this one, this L. So in computing this, we are not to solve for LC1 and LC2. So and then add it. That's not how we solve it. So for this, we could solve this by solving for the value of x and y. And we can solve x and y by using this triangle. And we solve it using sine law. So theta here is equal to 180 minus 67. We have computed for the length of your common tangent already. So I2 is x, and then I1 is for y. So from sine law, we can now compute for x equal to 115.191. Y is 100.935 meters. To solve for the chord length of the compound curve, we can now use cosine law. And we'll follow now this triangle. So, triangle formed by PI, PC, and PT. So unknown is L. We now know T1 and X, Y and T2, and we know that theta is equal to 180 minus 67, which is 113. So from there, we'll have now L squared equal to A squared plus B squared minus 2AB. So let's have A, which is T1 plus X, and B is T2 plus Y. So substituting now the values of A and B, 221.122 and 175.401, we get now the value of L, or the length of the cord, equal to 331.616 meters. So next, for our length of the compound curve, so the arc length of the whole compound curve, so that's L1 and L2. So we simply solve it by solving the individual lengths of curves 1 and 2. So that is LC1 and LC2. So from there, from geometry, we could simply have the relationship of a circle and an arc given by the circumference and the total angle of a circle, the equivalent arc and its equivalent I. So from here, for length of the curve for 1, that will be I is 31. So it will give us L1 of 206.667. And for L2, we use now I equal to 36. So that's 144 meters. So from there, the length of the compound curve, meaning the arc length now, is equal to L1 plus L2, or that's 350.667 meters. Next, for the stationing of PC, since the given is the station PI, so we can solve it by station PI minus the length of X and T1, so that's PC. So that's simply 100 plus 20, where this is station means the length is at 1020. So minus T1, 105.931, X is 115.21. So we'll get a value of 9798.878. In terms of station, that will now be, so divide this by 100, so you'll get 97. So plus whatever the remainder is, multiply it by 100, so that's 98.878. Or you simply count 2 here and then you insert the plus sign. So next we have station PT, and that will now be equivalent to the station of PC plus the total length of the curve. And we'll have now this value as 98.878 plus 350, or we'll get now 101 plus 49.545. So let's solve another problem. So we have the following given lines, or the lengths and directions of three lines. So we have AB, which is 57.6 meters due east. We have BC at 91.5 meters north, 68 degrees east, and CD is 102.6 meters with an azimuth from the south of 312 degrees. So a reverse curve is to be, or a reverse curve is set to connect these three lines. So this is our reverse curve. So let us compute now for the length of a common radius of the reverse curve. And if the station at point B is 123 plus 88, determine the stations of PC and PT. Okay. So to solve this, let's draw a diagram. So this one will be our curve 1 with radius 1. And then we have your second curve with radius 2. So to solve now for our radius or radius, this one now will be solved using our right triangle made by the radius and the tangent. And then for curve 2, it will now be solved by the triangle formed by the tangent and your radius 2. Okay? So to solve for this, we will need now the angle or the central angles of our curves. And for our central angles, this now can be solved using our... So from the triangles or right triangles formed by tangents and the radius, we have this equation. The tangent of I over 2 is equal to the tangent divided by the radius. So we do not know the tangent, we do not know the radius, but we can identify the values of your central angles. So for the first curve, we know that it is through the east or going to east. And line BC has a bearing of north 68 degrees. So as we know, the central angle is also equal to our intersection angle. So the intersection angle now between lines AB and BC will be equal to 22 degrees. And then we move on to the intersection angle for the second curve. So we know that for CD, it is 312 degrees from the south, or this one now is 48 degrees. So from BC, we know that it is equal to 68 degrees. So subtracting now our angle from 180. So 180 minus 68 degrees and minus 48 degrees, we will now have I2 equal to 64 degrees. So I1 now is the same as this angle and I2 is the same as, so I2 is equal to this angle also. Okay, so with all these values, we could now write or substitute the values of I to solve for our tangent and for our radius. So for curve 1, we can solve for T1 equal to R1 tangent of I1 2, or we'll have an equation T1 equal to R1 tangent of 11. Then for curve 2, same equation, just substitute the value of I2. So we'll have T2 is equal to R2 tangent of 32. So when we see a common radius, it means that R1 and R2 will be equal in magnitude. So since R1 is equal to R2, so we could substitute these values now into either R1 or R2. And from the figure and from our data, T1 plus T2 is equal to BC, which is now equal also to 91.5 meters. So with this, we could substitute now the values of T1 and T2. And that will give us now a value of radius equal to 111.69 meters. And from here, we can now solve for our stations. So for station PC, this is now equivalent to station B minus T1. So station B is given at 123 plus 88 minus T1, which is 21.71. So station PC now is equivalent to 123 plus 66.29. And for station PT, that is now station PC plus LC1 plus LC2, wherein LC can now be computed as I times pi R over 180. So with this, we now compute first for LC1 and LC2. For LC1, that is now 42.859 and LC2 is 124.759 meters. So substituting the values, the station PT is now equal to 123 plus 33.899 meters. So this is it for horizontal curves. Thank you for listening. For your activities, please wait for the posted evaluate questions.